5, 4, 3, 2, 1, live.
Welcome back, everybody. Thank you again to the previous panelists, the previous speakers. A big welcome to our team in country in Zimbabwe. Hope you guys have enjoyed the day so far. And as we move on to our next session, session 4, looking at social business and the impact of in sport in Africa. We've discussed all morning around the growing young population in Africa and the huge potential that has for development and the different sectors that can play a part. And so in this session, we'll work with the Yunus Sports Hub to look at how sport and social business can be used to create sustainable impact. So session will be moderated by Philemon Mbale. He is the English coordinator for Sports News Africa. He'll be joined by Johan Mugier, the co-founder and director of Yunus Sports Hub, Jean-Claude Bujana, the communication officer for Rwandan Olympic Committee, Dr. Aya Nichanda, Olympian swimmer, Pan-African Sport Foundation, Rachel Aron, CEO of Rumble Sports Africa, Emmanuel Sabata, the Ugandan IOC young leader, and Kishwa Mbad, the managing director of Grameen Health Services. So over to you, Philemon. I hope you guys have a great session.
Hello, thank you, Daniel, for such a warm welcome. And I want to say that we have the next 45 minutes to spend together. And believe me, it's the best cream. We've almost reserved the best for the last. My name is Philemon Mbale, like Daniel told you, and I'm going to be your moderator. I am in Cameroon. I'm a Cameroonian journalist. And I also double as the English desk coordinator for the Sports News Africa website, which is also a Pan-African sports website. And it's always a pleasure being in the company of such a wonderful and experienced cream of persons. Now, as we know that this is the fourth session, and of course our discussions will last for 45 minutes, the session description, let me quickly bring you the session description. As we know, Africa is at a tipping point. And of course, so the rapid demographic evolutions create a variety of socioeconomic challenges to overcome on the continent. At the same moment, and for the same reasons, Africa is seen as a land of opportunities for business across these sectors. In the next few years, Africa is set to become the new promised land of sports industry, which is, of course, structuring itself as we speak. Now, the big question remains, how can we use the social business concept and the structuration of the African sports industry as an opportunity to solve social problems in East Africa and most importantly, on the continent? Like Daniel introduced to you, let me quickly once more introduce our panelists for this session. The first will be Johan Nogbie, who is the co-founder and director of Yunus Sports Hub. We also have Jean-Claude Rudinaga, who is the communications officer for the Rwanda Olympic Committee. Dr. Aya Nakitanda, an Olympian swimmer and a Pan-African Sports Foundation from Uganda. We have Rachel Aron, the CEO of Rumble Sports Africa. We equally have Emmanuel Sebata from Uganda. He is an IOC young leader, and last but not least, Kishwa Mbad, the managing director of Grameen Healthcare Services Limited. And so these are the panel members. Let me go straight away and introduce our first panelist, who is Yuan Nogueira, who is formerly a procurement manager for the Rio 2016 and Olympic and Paralympic Games. Yuan met Professor Yunus at the beginning of 2017 while advocating about the potential social outcome of sporting events. And after a first successful collaboration resulting in the signing of an agreement with Paris 2024, the Yunus Sports Hub was created. Yuan, you are highly welcome and thanks for joining us this afternoon.
Thank you so much, Philemon. Thank you.
And I'm sure there's something you should add concerning your own bio. You have a long list of achievements there, but just quickly tell us a little more about yourself.
Yeah, so, I mean, when I first got involved in the movement through the Grameen Creative Lab, the idea was to see how we can, connect something that I could do, which was about sport, and something that I was really passionate about, which was social business. And the idea behind the Yunus Sports Hub is actually bringing these two worlds together. So we are making the interesting claim, I would say, that we are going to bring these two together by becoming the promoter and implementer of the social business concepts and techniques within sport. And what it means in particular, it means finding out what is it about sport that is powerful. You may have seen, you know, in a lot of articles, speech, a lot of conferences, that sport has a particular power to be solving social problems. And generally, especially when you look into Africa, what it is actually about, it is just, you know, providing access to sport to people, to generally underprivileged people, and thinking that this will basically change their life. What we're trying to bring with the Yunus Sports Hub and by inspiring ourselves from the ideas and the vision of Professor Yunus is to say, sport per se is not enough. You know, behind sport, what is needed is sport is just a vehicle. You know, it's just a fantastic mm-hmm. vehicle. It has power, but the reason why it has power is not for sports per se, but it is because it's a great platform to bring opportunities, to bring other kind of opportunities. So when you look into, you know, solving problems through sport, you may realize that that sport has particular power that other industry doesn't have. So if you look at the economic power of sport, this is pretty amazing power. You know, it's a $1.3 trillion US dollar industry. It's a huge industry. If you look even at the level at the bottom level, when you look into the organization of one event like the Paris 2024 Olympic Games, this is approximately 7 billion euros that we'll be spending to organize the games.
All right, Yuan, yes. maybe I'll get back to you in the course of our discussions. Let me quickly introduce the other panelists before we get into serious
okay,
business.
Okay, no problem. Go ahead.
Okay, so talk to you very shortly. We have Jean-Claude Ruginaga, who is, of course, he serves as IT and communication officer at the Rwanda National Olympic Committee. And his love and passion for the use of sports for social development led him to partake in the IOC Young Leaders and Commonwealth Youth Sports for Development and Peace Networks. He took his contribution to local sports to another level when he founded the Sport 14 Change Network. Hello, Jean-Claude, and thanks for joining us today.
Hi, Philemon, and thank you so much for having me.
Okay, so tell us a little more about yourself. We from your bio, we see that you are a leader. You champion the Sports 14 Change Network. Tell us a little more about yourself very quickly.
Thank you, Firamen. So I'm Jean-Claude Rijigana, as you said. I'm from Rwanda and working as IT and communication officer for National Olympic Committee. But I took part of the IOC Young Leaders program 2019-2020. So that leads me to be part also of the Yunus Sport Hub as a community leader for Africa. So I'm really passionate about social business. And I think also that's the reason behind of the creation of Sport for Change Media, where I'm the founder of it. So that's me briefly.
Okay, thanks very much, Jean-Claude. We shall be getting joining you again later in the session. Now, time for me to introduce a very powerful and influential lady, I should say. Rachel Aaron, I want to say warm welcome to you. Rachel is the CEO of Rumble Sports Africa, and also it's a seasoned social development advisor with over 16 years of experience in social due diligence on projects, programs, and policies in all regions of Africa. She's the Executive Vice President of the College Esports Expo, and she has worked at the international organizations like the African Development Bank Group and at civil society organizations. Rachel, if you are there with us, Thanks for joining us, and tell us a little more about yourself. Hello, Rasha.
Yes, thank you for the warm welcome. Good afternoon to everybody. I'm Rachel Aron. I just want to share that you've presented me quite well. Thank you. We're all very powerful in this space. I have deep personal and professional roots to East Africa. I am a Ugandan. My father's Ugandan. My mother's Kenyan. I've worked in countries overall. So I would just say that as a brief summary. That is who I am. And I look forward to engaging with everybody. Thank you.
Thank you so very much. And we shall be hoping to reap a lot from your huge experience on the African continent. Next on the line, Dr. Aya Nakitanda. Interestingly, she's an Olympian and a swimmer, 10 times national champion and multiple record holder in swimming. She competed for Uganda internationally for 10 good years. Doctor, if you are there, thanks for joining us and tell us a little more about yourself and your swimming experience, briefly.
Yeah, thank you, Philemon, for the nice introduction and a good afternoon to everybody in the audience. It's really an honor for me to speak today, to have the opportunity to share with everyone. And like you said, indeed, I don't know why I don't look like one, but I am an Olympian swimmer and I competed internationally. But since I stopped competing, I've also served in several leadership roles within sports, specifically in the areas of anti-doping, female athlete health, and providing career support to athletes. So I've worked with our National Olympic Committee, with the World Anti-Doping Agency, and the International Olympic Committee. Professionally, I'm a medical doctor. And I hope I look one. I'm currently actually pursuing my doctorate. But today I'm here to speak as one of the founders of the Pan-African Sport Foundation, which I founded together with Kadi Kanute, who I believe is in the audience today with us. And we would like to be the strongest sports movement in Africa, to advance solidarity and development in Africa through sport.
Oh, thank you very much, Doctor. And we hope to get back to you to discover more about you. Now, the next panelist studied sports economy and industry at Beijing Sports University and worked as a graduate fellow in the Department of Sports Science in Kiambogo University. He has a unique interest in research on Olympics, sports tourism, event heritage, culture, and sustainability. He is committed to using sports education to impact change. Emmanuel Sebata, if you are there, please join us and tell us a little more about yourself.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Philemon, for that wonderful introduction. Please also allow me to take this opportunity to thank our beautiful audience for their time and efforts to be part of this wonderful forum. Basically, what I can say is that currently I am a postgraduate student at the Sport Business School of Beijing Sport University in China. But also this year in 2021, I was selected to represent Uganda on the IOC Young Leaders Program. And we are currently being mentored by the Yunus Sport Hub and the IOC to becoming the new generation of the IOC young leaders who can impact change using sport in our different local communities. I'm so humbled to be part of this forum. Thank you so much. Back to you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Emmanuel Sebata. And of course, as if it was planned, we reserve the best for the last. Kishwa Imdad, his profile is so long and huge that I will just call upon him. Sir, if you are there, thanks for joining us and tell us a little more about yourself in under 2 minutes.
Good evening. Thank you for having me in this exciting forum. My name is Kishwa Imdad. Currently, I'm performing responsibilities as Managing Director of Grameen Healthcare Services, Grameen Healthcare Service is a social business organization. We have four eye hospitals at district level. This organization started its operation from 2007. So we are actually serving all kinds of people at the district level out of Dhaka. We have four eye hospitals. And we are also providing management support to a nursing college, Caledonian College of Nursing. In addition, I'm also involved with another organization. It's called Samajik Health Science Institute. We are actually involved with a 500-bed hospital project that will be in operation, hopefully, in next, I think, in 2024. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Imdad. And so let's take this back all to the top, where we shall be inviting our first panelist to have a Q&A discussion. Yuan, are you there?
Yes, of course.
Of course, you should be there. So now tell us, Yuan, Professor Yunus' work shows us that social business is sector agnostic. It can apply in any industry. In his opening speech at the 129th session of the International Olympic Committee at the Rio 2016 Olympics and Paralympic Games, Professor Yunus said this, and I quote, "I always felt amazed at the limitless power of sports. It is powerful because it is basic to human nature. Where there is power, there is always a chance to make a meaningful difference in people's lives. What are the powers of sports and how can we activate those powers in East Africa as well as on the entire continent?"
Yeah, Filemon, I just realized I really jumped the gun before. So I started to answer this question before, but that's perfect. Then it's a good transition then. So what I was trying to say earlier was that when you look at the power that sport has, you can see that, of course, in the way that access to sport is a great contributor to provide value to young people. But if you look at the complex circle of poverty, just providing access to sport will not change many things in the life of people. So when we talk about the power of sport, it's about what is this power and how do we activate it? What is this power? You know, it's, as I was saying, you know, that's the economic power. That's $1.3 trillion business. If you take the example of the games in Paris, this is €7 billion budget, which if you compare it to the budget of the city of Paris, this is 1 year of the budget of the city of Paris. And we will spend that in 5 weeks for the Olympic Games. But when you look into what this money is about, this is money that exists because of sport. So this is not a waste of money. This is actually an opportunity to do something good. And this is exactly what I mean by, you know, trying to identify this power, so the economic power, and leverage it towards a social direction. So what we're doing in Paris with the Olympics is that we're trying to, out of these €7 billion that will be spent for suppliers of product and services, we're trying to maximize the amount of social businesses that are going to be contracted through this event. So if you take, for example, the contracting of the food for the games, you need to provide food for 14,000 athletes, and athletes eat a lot. you need a lot of food. And if you work with social business catering company that only works with refugees or long-term unemployed people, then you have the exact same product, which is the food, but a completely different situation on the ground, because you are actually providing a solution to local problems. So this is one example of what this power of sport is and how it can be used towards a social direction. And if you take a second example, this is about, you know, half the planet watching the games. You have a fantastic, I mean, no sector can say that you have this amount of people mobilized at the same time. It's unique. And what we can do to leverage this power is, for example, trying to make sure that we connect this power of attraction to resolution of social problems. So an example that I would like to give that is happening in Africa, in West Africa this time, is the example of the Agora, where we are bringing young people in a sports center made out of recycled container, which hosts social business. So the young people go to this sports center, they see that they are exposed to this social business, which provide them access to affordable healthcare, affordable eye care, incubation of micro business. And through that, then they can get access to these economic opportunities. And of course, this center is self-sustainable because these social businesses have a business model and they can pay for the operation of the whole center.
All right, all right. That's. I think it's very clear how you intend to go about spotting out the powers, the opportunities in sports. And now, before I let you go, Africa is at a tipping point. Of course, the rapid demographic evolutions create a variety of social economic challenges to overcome. How can our sector look to young people to develop solutions to these challenges? How can social business sustain these solutions?
I would say mainly by not repeating the mistakes that have been made by the rest of the sports sector. I mean, this is a fantastic opportunity that Africa has in terms of the structuration of the sport industry. Because okay, if you look into the sport world as it is today, it's of course, as we were saying before, a fantastic platform to solve problems. But it is also like any other sector. It is also a big land of problems. There are a lot of problems in sports. If you take wealth distribution, this is actually it looks like an impression of the society. You have a few athletes earning millions, even mm-hmm. billions, and most of the other just struggling financially. And what we should say, what we should try to do is like, how do we structure this sector that is rapidly growing in a way that this does not happen? One of the great examples that I'd like to give, and that Aya mentioned before, is the work of the International Olympic Committee when it comes to athlete support through entrepreneurship with the IOC Athlete 365 Business Accelerator, where the idea is to support athletes by providing them the skills, the tools to become entrepreneurs as a way to finance their career or post-career. So this is the kind of tools that we have in our hand to make a difference and make sure that the sports sector structures itself in the best way.
All right. Thank you so much, Yuan. If time permits, we'll be coming back to you. Now, next, let us introduce Jean-Claude Ruginaga. Jean-Claude, I will go straight. In your role as the communication officer at the Rwandan Olympic Committee, what messages do you aim to share about sports and its role in society?
Thank you again, Philemon, for this opportunity. To start, let me say that the message, I will make it brief and in one sentence. So we try to spread the power of sport and its impact as Yohan was talking about earlier. So, but also we promote also the Olympism. So to give more details, the role of the National Olympic Committee is for being responsible for the development and the protection of the Olympic movement, the representation of the Rwanda at the Olympic Games, promote the fundamentals and the values of the Olympics, and also promoting sport for all in our society. So the message behind the content we are sharing on our platform's website is just to share with the community or the world, the achievement our athletes are trying to make, but also the impact the National Olympic Committee is having or contributing to different government initiatives through sports projects we are having.
All right, now, quickly, how does your platform, you run a platform, Sports for Change Media, how does that develop and share solutions with the audience? How do you engage with young generation through your different channels? How do you do that?
Thank you so much. So the project idea of Sport for Change Media came up when I was learning my IOC and Grida project, where I was using sport, especially karate, to promote the Olympic values and the third SDG among the Rwandan community. So I have realized that there is a misconception about sport. not only in Rwanda, but also in Africa. But also we need to encourage our youth to take part in the sporting movement. So the main goal of Sport for Change Media, it's of course a national media house, and it's trying to encourage youth to take a part in the Olympic movement or in sport movement in general, but also changing the people's misconception about sport through media. So we are trying to share inspiring content, but I would like also to mention that from the 7th April here in Rwanda, and rest of the world, we began the 100 commemoration period to remember and honor the victims of 1994 genocide against the Tutsi. So with that tragedy, I have experienced that sport has played a big role in the recovery of my country. So we're trying to read the different inspiring stories of how sport has helped the different peoples to survive, also to live or to gain life after that tragedy. So it's about inspiring young generation. So about engaging with the young generation, you know that many of youth are using social media. So we are going to get them there. So to interact with them, and the pictures attract them, and the different content, but short ones. So we are using different platforms. They are up to them right now. So, and so far we are 6 as a team of Sport for Change Media. So, and we hope to create more jobs in the future. Thank you.
All right, wish you well with your team, and we hope that the desired impact is felt in Rwanda and as well as in other parts of East Africa. Let me quickly bring in Rachel Aron. Rachel, I'll go straight to my question. Tell us about Rumble Sports Africa. I'm so much interested about knowing that, as well as the panelists, as well as the audience. Tell us a little more about Rumble Sports Africa and the link with social business.
Okay. Thank you, Philomen. So Rumble Sports Africa is part of Rumble Worldwide, which is a social enterprise that was created to support youth entrepreneurship programs in Africa and in North America. Rumble Sports Africa facilitates the promotion of sports events, programs, and activities across Africa. And we do this by integrating social enterprise, social inclusion, gender equality, and social development dimensions that contribute to the socio-cultural and socio-economic growth prospects of African countries through sports. Now, we have developed some unique programs and initiatives, such as the Naomi Ruth Barber King Sports for Social Change Scholarship Fund. So Mrs. Naomi King is actually the wife of the late Alfred Daniel King, who was a civil rights activist in the US and also the younger brother of Martin Luther King Jr. So through this scholarship fund, we're furthering Mrs. King's dream of investing in youth and social impact. And the scholarship fund will also serve to target students, male and female, who are passionate about sports and about the business of sports to address social problems. We've also developed a sports media and communication skills program will serve to strengthen women's capacities to work throughout the sports media and communications value chain, which is important. So they're embedded at different parts. Because our goal is really that we shift more gender responsive, and I'm talking about media content here, that's relevant to African women's needs and perspective.
Well, we seem to be having some connection issues there with Aron. Aron, are you there? Aron, can you hear me?
Yes, I'm back. Can you hear me?
Okay. Right on, please.
Perfect. Yes, sorry. Electricity challenges in South Africa sometimes. And finally, the final final proposal developed is a sports tourism, which is based in terms of community-based in its focus. So through this sports tourism program, we're hoping to promote cultural heritage, environmental protection and conservation, as well as peace and conflict resolution. And through the sports tourism program, we hope to introduce innovation through what's called virtual sports tourism and the use of digital technologies. Thank you. This is, in a summary, what Rumble Sports Africa is about.
Okay. Fortunately, we could get a couple of ideas there, even though the connection wasn't very good. But very quickly, Aaron, in your past at the African Development Bank.
Sorry, I couldn't hear you.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Can you hear me, Aaron? Aaron, can you hear me? Well, unfortunately, we can't get the best out of Aaron in this discussion, but hopefully we shall be coming back to her towards the end of the discussions. Let me bring in Dr. Aya. Dr. Aya, through your participation in the IOC program, permit me, the Athletes 365 Business Acceleration Program, which is operated by the Yunus Sports Hub, you have created the Pan-African Sports Foundation. With the foundation, you share a vision of a unified and empowered sports ecosystem where African athletes can reach their potentials on and off the pitch and also be recognized for their achievements. That is huge, by the way. Now, what role can African athletes play in the development of sports industry in Africa?
Thank you, Philemon, for that important question. And I feel it's important because this platform today gives me the opportunity to talk on behalf of all the athletes in Africa. So I want to stress that I believe that African athletes like myself have the biggest role to play in developing the sports industry in Africa. And this is for so many reasons. I mean, we athletes are the people who have most closely experienced the power of sport in our lives and possibly the impact in our societies. We know the dynamics of sport. We know that sport isn't in a vacuum. We know how it's interconnected with many other sectors. And we know how sport can drive the economy through creating jobs and the development of infrastructure. Of course, we have also established various international networks within sport that would be very valuable in developing the sports sector in Africa. But going back to what role specifically, I want to start by talking about professional athletes that Johan referred to. In Africa, we have professional athletes, and of course, including those in the diaspora that earn a living through sports and even have significant savings to invest back into sport in Africa and create opportunities for the youth. And these opportunities are not only for the youth to just engage in sports, but to become competitive athletes, coaches, technical officials, medical professionals, the media, event organizers, even the garment industry, and of course, tour and travel. But of course, on the other hand, I mean, it's not all about money, and not every athlete has earned big from sport. But I want to also say that the many years of hardcore training and high-level competition that we go through as athletes has inevitably made us very hardworking, resilient, creative, and disciplined. So these are definitely qualities that will play well in sports business and demonstrate that athletes would make good employees in sports or even as sports entrepreneurs. And then, unfortunately, after saying all this, I have to say that despite our potential, skills, and qualities, most African athletes are not empowered or well-informed to be able to play a key role in advancing sports, the sports industry in Africa. I mean, many of our athletes have not had the opportunity to go far with education because the system still believes that sport is for those who maybe failed in school. In Africa, we also haven't given much recognition to our athletes for their amazing achievements. I mean, we have world champions, we have world record holders, we have several Olympians, but many do not know their own value or realize their personal brand. And this is a paradigm that we actually want to change as Pan-African Sports Foundation, because athletes should be the leaders of the sports industry in Africa. And I want to say that Pan-African Sports Foundation is an athlete-led continental sports movement, and we intend to work for athletes and the broader African society. We want to see that our athletes are recognized. We intend to have a flagship award events and event galas. We would also like to continue supporting our athletes better prepare for their life after competitive sports.
Interesting.
And,
interesting.
Yeah. As you rightly mentioned, I was part of the IOC's Business Accelerator Program, and I got business training from the Yunus Sports Hub, without which I do not think I would have even given serious thoughts about starting a social business that is our Pan-African Sports Foundation. I have a career as a medical doctor, but I feel, you know, I have extra meaning in life to have this opportunity to support sport development in Africa through the foundation.
My final point I just want to drive home today is that
we athletes have a lot of vision and potential to lead the sports industry in Africa. We probably need more support, but I want to request the industry players to definitely engage more with athletes. Thank you.
Your message, Mustafa, very finely gone across. Time for me to bring in Emmanuel Sebata. Emmanuel, remember, he told us he's actually working on a program. Emmanuel, as an IOC young leader representing Uganda, please share your ideas for potential social business in sports and how they can offer local solutions in Uganda.
Thank you so much, Philemon. Actually, it is very important for me before I tap into that question to mention that this forum comes at a time when sport is booming as a business globally. In Africa, actually, we can see that sport has started to gain momentum as a business. And therefore, that is why we see that so many African governments now, they have started redirecting their efforts towards the sport industry or the sports sector. In fact, when you look at East Africa and Uganda in particular, the governments or our governments in Africa, even in general, they have started earmarking sport as one of those sectors that are going to help transform our economies into the middle income status. Therefore, this means that sport has now become a very, very key sector in our economy. And now to answer your question about the potential social businesses and how they can offer local solutions, I would want to tell you that before we actually really look at the business ideas or the businesses in Africa, we need to first understand what are the problems that Africa as a continent is facing. Because I do believe that any organization, any institution, or any project that does not understand the social problems of a society or community cannot drive change in that particular society. Therefore, it is important for us to first understand what are those problems that actually Africa is facing. So when you look at the challenges like the increasing number of youthful population in Africa, and the population which is actually unemployed, and then you look at challenges like the increase in crime, increase in violence, increase in drug abuse. When you look at challenges that challenges like the increasing dropout rates from the schools, the prevalence of diseases like HIV, AIDS, political instabilities, challenges like hunger, the low economic growth rate, and of late, or currently, the latest is the COVID pandemic, you find out that these problems actually, we call for social business ideas that should solve these actual problems. Therefore, any social business idea that is not geared towards solving these problems I have mentioned above, I think would not be feasible enough and would not be very, very important for Africa at the moment. So that is why you find that social business ideas like grassroots sports projects, like sports academies. You can see my brother from Rwanda has a project related to Taekwondo. It is a very good project that can promote grassroots sport. When you look at projects like sports coaching programs, education and physical education projects, projects like sports training projects, advocacy projects, sports tourism projects, talent development projects, mentorship projects, skilling projects. Those are the projects that can be able to address those problems above. I can give an example of sports tourism, for example. When you look at our African economies, most of these economies are hugely dependent on the tourism sector. But however, research has been done in Uganda, for example, and it has found out that these animals, the wildlife, which we rely on, the numbers of animals, the gorillas, the zebras, the elephants that we have in our national parks are reducing in number day by day. In fact, some of these animals are undergoing extinction. This means that in the next 1, 2, 3 decades, we shall not be able to continue relying on these animals as tourism attraction. Therefore, that means that our tourism sector remains in danger. So what we need is something that can come in as a substitution or as a support system to the tourism industry. And sport has proven to do this because apart from just having close linkages with tourism, sport itself is a sport attraction. Therefore, if we encourage our youth to engage themselves in sport tourism related business, we shall be strongly improving and enhancing the tourism sector. And at the end of the day, we shall be able to solve the problems above, for example, the unemployment problem, because the sector creates so many opportunities for the people. When you look at projects,
Emmanuel, I must say thank you very much, my brother from Uganda. And hopefully the message has gone across. We need to shift our paradigm from solving problems using sports, as you rightly put it there. And so time good enough for me to talk to our last panelist, Kishwa Imdad. Dear Kishwa, you are certainly the most, of course, the greatest, I should say, expert of social business on this panel. Now, by managing one of the biggest social businesses ever created in Bangladesh, what does this development of the social business concept in sports world inspire you? And again, what are the lessons learned in the health sector in Bangladesh, which could be applied to the sports industry over here in Africa?
Okay, that's a very good question. Actually, when you talk about sports, the first thing that inspires me is the spirit of human being. In fact, to me, sports represent 5 S: stamina, strength, speed, skill, and spirit. So apparently the concept of social business and the power of sports is not directly related. Social business has a potent ability to ignite change through solving social problems. And the sports have also the ability to solve social problems, particularly to resolve conflicts and marketing peace, not only between 2 persons or 2 groups, but also between 2 nations at global level. The ping pong diplomacy is a very well-known diplomacy, we know. This brings peace between USA and China in early 70s. As Professor Yunus said, sports is powerful because it is basic to human beings. The games and sports have the inherent power to bring peace together, to bring people together, and to express solidarity. It always inspired me to observe how social business concept is being used as a game-changing tool to unleash the social sports sector's potential for large-scale social transformation. A remarkable example I can give, an organization called 365 Business Accelerator. Yuan is related to that organization, which is working to find a solution to transform the former athletes to entrepreneurs. An initiative launched by the IOC in 2019, the Business Accelerator empowers athletes globally to become entrepreneurs by aiding and guiding their career transition. The active professional life of an athlete or player is very short. Most of the players started their career at their early 80s and retired in early 30s. After that, some players act as coach, some become commentators. I can give some example from South Asia, South Asian arena. Former cricket player Sunil Gavaskar, Ajay Manjrekar, Ravi Shastri successfully transformed their career as sports commentator, coach, and entrepreneurs. Mamun Babu, a former football player of Bangladesh national football team, has successfully built a career in business organizations. These are the few examples of successful transition to a new career. Although athletes and players have a lot of opportunities and potential to contribute in the economy and society at large, but however, a big number of players, as you mentioned earlier, become inactive to spend laid-back life after their retirement. So capitalizing their potentiality, they have the opportunity to be successful entrepreneurs, brand ambassadors, peace negotiators, even healthcare management professionals, and so on. The opportunity is limitless. All they need is a platform that will help them for successful for their successful transition to a new career. When you talk about that, you also ask about that, what are my lessons learned from the health sector in Bangladesh and how it could be applied to a sports sector in Africa. Okay, I'll make it very short. Shortly, I'll say that sports injury is a common phenomenon of players and athletes. I worked in hospital for last 10 years. I have seen some players and sports person become demoralized when they have to refrain from games while they are under physician's treatment due to sports and injuries. These young people need moral boost up, physiotherapy, and coaching to go back to their regular professional lives. The former players and athletes can play a vital role as healthcare counselor, motivators for the players who are normally broken down due to sports injuries and in some cases recovering from temporary disabilities. I would say sports professional can play a vital role in healthcare sector. And I can give some examples here. Mashrafi bin Murtaza, he's a former cricket player and former team captain of Bangladesh national cricket team, who is playing a vital role in transforming his hometown Norai to a livable city. He introduced free ambulance service for less privileged patients and improved the healthcare services, particularly by modernizing the Norai district hospital. In 2017, he formed a social organization called Norai Express Foundation, which is working to facilitate modern sanitary system in rural sectors, and also he's facilitating pure drinking water for public places. Sure. So he set a very good example. So players have a lot of qualities to become successful entrepreneurs, particularly in healthcare, to apply social business concept. Mm-hmm. And so the players and Olympic athletes have a celebrative value which they can capitalize as brand ambassadors for healthcare sectors. Mm-hmm. I would say athletes, players, and sports professional of East Africa can learn from these examples and utilize their potentials to become successful entrepreneurs of social businesses and contribute in the economy by solving social healthcare and environmental problems in East Africa. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. And I want to say that it's been a wonderful session. I want to say that these conferences should come up as often as possible so that at the end of the day, Africa benefits, sports benefits, athletes. We all benefit as stakeholders in the industry. And so it is on that note. Daniel, if you are there, I think this is where my job comes to an end, if you permit me.
Philemon, I think that we have Rachel. Rachel is back, maybe for 1 minute to give the closing word, because she's been cut before. Just for 1 minute. I know that we're a bit late, but that at least she has the time to have a closing word.
You are very correct. Rachel, if you are there, you have the next 1 minute, 30 seconds to tell us more on what you were saying. Please go
ahead. Sure. Can you hear me all now? I'm on 4G.
Perfect.
Okay. Just to go further briefly about, based on my experience working at the African Development Bank and the rise of different sectors across Africa, I think there's some lessons that can be applied to the African sports industry. And I'd like to share those, just listing them. One is the African sports industry needs to understand the social and cultural dynamics at the community, local, national, and regional levels, and the interlinkages at all four. Secondly, the industry needs to invest in socio-cultural analyses that include social inclusion, disability inclusion, and gender and vulnerability, really honing into those areas. Thirdly, the African sports industry should incorporate fragility assessments, coming out of the fact that a lot of our countries are faced with fragility in the form of terrorism, huge income equality gaps, armed conflicts, et cetera. Four, the sports industry in Africa needs to concentrate on demonstrating its full business case and its entire business value. That means investing seriously in building capacities in terms of financing models, feasibility studies, environmental and social impact assessments, and risk analysis. Five, there needs to be a serious effort to promote sports and development, meaning linking it to the Sustainable Development Goals and the African Union's Agenda 2063. Six, there are a lot of small SMEs in the African sports industry that need support. So interventions need to be designed to help them access capital and to build their capacity to use the capital meaningfully. Seven, there's a need to explore interlinkages between sports and other sectors, such as transport, energy, IT, and agriculture, to create synergies because they're naturally interlinked. Eight, there's a need to look at not only creating jobs, but creating quality jobs. That means moving out of your traditional comfort zones to look at opportunities in the digital economy and sports. Looking at also within the sports, the subsectors such as the sports and esports that's growing and has a lot of potential. And last and finally, I believe that there needs to be a deep appreciation that climate change has a substantive impact on the sports industry in Africa. Climate change impacts related to waste management, carbon footprints, and health implications. So a number of our countries have made global commitments at a high level, such as the Paris Agreement that was led by UNFCCC, and as well as the Global Action Plan on Physical Activity from 2018 to 2030, which was led by the WHO. We need to be able to translate these global commitments at a national level, but apply it incorporating sports. So thank you so much. That is all I have to add. I thank you all for your time. It's been a pleasure.
And to imagine that we almost missed all of what you said. I mean, it's really been an enriching session, I want to confess. And like I always say, it's a pleasure for me to be your moderator, people of high quality, people of high caliber. And we hope that we push the sports agenda. We hope that at the end of the day, we can be able to solve social problems on the continent using a social business concept. Daniel, are you there?
Thank you so much, Willem. Yes, and thank you again to your fantastic panel for that. Always great to hear about what's coming up. As a big sports fan myself, definitely looking forward to hearing how it's going to happen. Thanks again to everybody for joining us for that session. So we have a short break before the next session where Pod MC Shihab will be introducing. But I want to take the chance again to say a huge thank you once again to all our panelists, all our audience, our team and audience members in Zimbabwe at Capital University. Hope you've enjoyed today. Hope it's been everything that that we hoped.
Thank you. Thank you to all of you, the moderator.
Thank you.
Everybody and Yuan for organizing this fantastic work. This is a good thing. Get to know you and we'll keep in touch with each other. Thank you.
Thank you,
sir. Thank you.